guy who prayed for 4 months to make sure he knew what it was God wanted him to do. He left his cushy job with the king and went back to his decimated homeland to try to rebuild things. And he didn't just rebuild a wall. He did that. But he also rebuilt a community. He helped to bring back a people. He is one of my biblical heroes, Nehemiah. And in the passage that we read today, the walls have been completed. But that's just part of the journey. The city had no infrastructure. There was a long way to go. This was their home, and it had been destroyed. And it was a long road before it would ever come back again, and it certainly wasn't going to look like it had before. But Nehemiah and Ezra, the priest, gathered everyone together, and they read to them from the scriptures. They read to them the word of the Lord. And they told them, this is not a time to grieve or to mourn. Today is a celebration. We are not frivolous. We know there is work ahead, and we know that it's not going to be easy, but today is a celebration because the joy of the Lord is our strength. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Joy makes us strong. The joy of the Lord is our strength. The joy that we find in reveling in who we are, made in God's image. The joy that we find in reveling in whose we are, children of God. When we are joyful, we build our strength. And just when are we more joyful than we are when we are doing something that we love? Whether it is reading a good book, or climbing a mountain, or playing with a grandchild, or even taking a nap in the middle of the day. When are we more joyful than when we are doing something that we love? When are we more joyful than when we have taken some time to laugh and to play? So could it be that play makes us strong? Stuart Brown has spent the last 40 years of his life doing research on play. And interestingly enough, he started this research because he was researching criminals. He was doing a study on criminals, and not just any criminals, men who had committed murder. This is who he was studying. And one common thread that he found, while there are a number of factors, as we all know, there is no one cause for criminal behavior. There is no one reason why people do bad things. But the one commonality he found almost without fail in these men who had committed murder was that in their childhood, their ability to play had been non-existent or it had been interrupted. Either they had not been allowed to play, or their lives were so scheduled there was no time to play, or there had been some traumatic event that interrupted a childhood of play. Almost without fail, this disruption in the ability to play as a child was a common factor among these men. So Stuart began to study play. And he, along with other people, began to realize how important play is in our development. It's when we play, that's where we first learn how to share. That's how we first learn how to get along with others. It's how we learn to adapt and change. Oh, look, we were playing this, but now Timmy's here and wants to play too. Let's alter so that we can include him. Well, we were playing kickball, but the bus just ran over our ball, so now we're playing tag. It is through play that we learn a good number of our coping and adaptability skills as adults. And so Brown began to take all of these play histories of people, thousands and thousands of play histories, and as he studied the importance of play as children, he began to notice that there were some adults who continued to play into adulthood and throughout adulthood, and then there were others who stopped when childhood ended. And he noted a difference in the lives of these two groups. It is Brown's assertion that we are designed by nature to participate and engage in play throughout our entire lives. Brown says we are designed by nature. We are Christians. We would say we were designed by God. We were created that way. Could it be that we were created for play? You know, the very first line in the Westminster Shorter Catechism, Katie, do you know this one? Is that a Lutheran thing, the Westminster Catechism?
Weaver.
You have your own catechism. All right. Maybe, Sally, Westminster Catechism? Ah, Catholics will know. What is our aim, our purpose in life? Anybody know what the answer is?
Praise God and find joy in God's being forever.
To glorify God and enjoy God forever. That is why we're here. The joy of the Lord is our strength. How are we doing on the joy these days? You know, as kids, most of us probably had pretty active play lives. But somewhere along the way, we got working on our careers, we got married, we had kids, we started climbing the ladder, we started exercising because our cholesterol was too high, not because it was fun. And we let play go by the wayside. After all, play is for children and it has no place in our adult world. We are serious people about serious business and we need to be serious about it. Seriously. The idea of play, I would argue, breaks the number one rule in our society today. The number one rule is, above all, you must be productive. Play itself lies in the face of that. Play, by definition, is not productive. It is done for its own sake. It is done because it brings joy. It is not done to produce something that you can sell, buy, or produce something else with. The Old Testament guru Walter Brueggemann would probably say that thousands of years after our spiritual ancestors were freed from slavery in Egypt, that we find ourselves as slaves to Pharaoh. Because Pharaoh was all about production. Pharaoh wanted more bricks. He wanted more bricks made in less time with fewer resources. And it was this drive to produce more bricks that caused the oppression of the Hebrew children. It was this drive for production that caused them to cut and run, to go out into the wilderness. They escaped. And here we find ourselves modern-day America, slaves to these cycles of production and consumption in which there is no room for something as useless as play. But what Brown has found out through his studies, and others concur, is that those people who continue to play into their adulthood are actually more creative and more innovative and, in fact, more productive than those who stopped at the onset of adulthood. It seems to be important that we play. Now, play can be different things for different people. Play for you could be spending an hour going through old vinyl records and playing them and remembering where you were the first time you heard that song. Play could be sitting out by a babbling brook and watching the water for half an hour without thinking about what has to be done next. I love to go and escape to the movies. There is nothing better than getting to spend the afternoon or the evening in a great movie. But I have a friend for whom sitting still for doing it right, worship should fall into Stuart Brown's definition of play. After all, worship serves no purpose in terms of how the world would define it. We don't produce anything here. We won't have solved any problems by the time that we leave here. There will be nothing to sell. There will be nothing to produce. We have come to worship because it brings us joy to worship, because our God told us to worship, and it pleases us to be obedient to God. For most of us, it is voluntary. Some of our children and perhaps a couple of spouses may disagree, but for most of us, coming to worship is a voluntary activity. There should be worship at its best, a lack of self-consciousness. How many times have I said it? Come and worship just the way you are. However you are dressed, however you are feeling, you can be in a good mood or a bad mood. You can be dressed to go, you know, muck out horse stalls, or you can be dressed to the nines. Come as you are. Leave self-consciousness at the door. It is something, hopefully, if it goes well, and you have had an experience and an encounter with the Holy, it is something that you want to engage in again. I would argue that worship at its best is indeed play. It is so important to take the time to play, that we take the time to engage in the things that help us to be joyful, to find our joy in the Lord. Because if it is the joy of the Lord that gives us the strength, we're going to need all that we can get, because the floodwaters will rise and the tornadoes will destroy. And careers will tank, and relationships will crumble, and the diagnoses will be bad, and there will be grief that is so powerful it knocks us to our knees, and we don't think we're ever going to be able to get up again. We need the strength that we build from the times we experience joy. So if you think that you are too old, are too busy, are too important to play, then you are saying that you know better than God. When you decide that play has no purpose and no place in your life, then you are denying who you are and you are defying the one who made you. The joy of the Lord is our strength. And when we are not feeling that, when we do not have that lightness in our lives, we should take that as seriously as we would chest pains or shortness of breath. It is crucial to our health. It is crucial to our survival. It is crucial to being God's people in this world today. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Our purpose.